Knowledge is power, and this is Powerful Stuff. Wellness Education Cannabis Advocates of Nevada present the Weekend 702 Nevada Cannabis News Hour with your host, Jen Solis. For the next 60 minutes, we'll take an in-depth look at the cannabis reform revolution sweeping the nation. The phone lines are open at 731-1230. That's 731-1230. Or toll-free. 1-866-820-5528. That's 1-866-820-KLAV. Now, let's bring on the host. Here is Jen Solis.
Hi, everybody. This is Jennifer Solis reporting for Nevada Cannabis News. To my right is Kurt Dukoc, Raymond Fletcher, Perry Haichu, and William Beach Baker is our producer. On the board, making me sound so good every week, is Lawrence. Thank you so much. All right, now for our local news. Some of our local news will go right to Raymond. What's going on, Raymond?
Hands up, don't shoot.
Sorry, I had to. State county pot dispensary class could spark clash, could spark lawsuits. We began talking about this last week.
We began talking about this last year, like 9 months ago.
Yeah, like in our first episode, I think we were mentioning that.
Right, okay, but now it has officially made the news. Las Vegas approved 27 medical marijuana dispensaries in October, more than double the number of shops set aside for the city of Nevada by regulators.
Yep.
Councilman and good friend Bob Coffin said the city made a conscious choice to approve extra dispensaries in an effort to avoid putting itself on a crash course with the state. Coffin, a longtime medical marijuana advocate, said the decision is paying dividends. Quote, "We're trying to avoid the confrontational approach the county took," Coffin said. "Ultimately, the state has a hammer. They get the final say under the law. We took a big step in approving more dispensaries than the state asked for. So, in essence, we can open 10 of 12 dispensaries whenever the owner's desire."
Yeah, because only 10 of them received state approval out of 22.
Yeah, that's right. I have a little piece of news in addition to that. Let's see here. County Manager Don Burnett contacted Chad Westham, Bureau Chief of the Nevada Division of Public and Behavioral Health, on November 13th after the state's rankings showed that only 10 of the 18 possible dispensaries would be allowed in unincorporated Clark County. The county's letter to Westham pointed to minutes of a July 9th meeting of the state subcommittee on the medical use of marijuana. According to the minutes, Westham said that the state would come up with the highest 18 rankings in Clark County and issue provisional certificates. The county, quote, "then had the option of denying the businesses at a local level. If they are denied at the local level, then the state would also deny them, and the state would let Clark County know who was the next ranked entity," end quote, according to the minutes of Westham's comments. "Can we still rely on this testimony?" Mr. Burnett was later asked in the letter. By November 18th, the state responded, saying that Westham's comments about moving down to the next ranked applicant had not taken into account the need for the state to issue all provisional certificates within 90 days of receiving an application. "At this time, the state does not have the authority to move down to the next ranked applicant or issue any more provisional certificates," Richard Whiteley, a state administrator, wrote to the county. "That 90-day period expired on November 3rd, which is why I was talking about during the last time I was on the show, we need to have a special legislative session to clear this issue up immediately."
Well, doesn't legislature begin the first week of January?
First week of February.
And so, I mean, that's soon enough, I think. Wouldn't it be?
It's soon enough. But my question now is, if we wait for the legislature to go into session, do we then have to wait for the end of the 110-day legislative session in order for those laws to take effect? Which would then, like I was saying a few weeks ago, this is a problem because I think that we already had budgeted money during last session for the expected or predicted revenue that the medical marijuana dispensaries would bring in tax revenue. So if none of these shops are open during session, how are we going to provide the state with any of the revenue that we promised them? I mean, we're going to come in like way under budget. Obviously, we'll have no revenue to go with. And that's why I'm so nervous about this. Even though it might cost money to call these people in right now, we need these shops open to get this promised tax revenue in pronto.
Well, I was going to say there are some people that are poised to open already. I think Euphoria Wellness, they said that they were poised to open as a dispensary buying patients' products to do this.
Yeah, I heard that. By January 12th is their target date that they want to open. And in theory, I think they can open unless somebody steps in, like a judge or something like that, and stops this whole process. I think that'll be the only thing that can actually stop them from opening at this point, because they have a certificate from the county and from the state, one of the very few who have both, correct?
Yeah, they have both. I wouldn't be too worried about a judge stepping in and stopping them. I'd be more worried about Metro coming in and stopping whoever's growing what they're going to be planning on selling in January.
Well, they're planning the production facilities that are licensed?
Yeah, exactly.
No, they're planning... Euphoria Wellness is actually planning on purchasing from patients.
Right, that's what I read also, and that should be... That's written into the law. It's
I mean, I talked to the executive director, I think, over there. Her name is Darlene, and Darlene was... Yeah, this is what we are doing. This is what we want to do. And they already have their staff and everything, ready to go.
Do we have any clarification about how many times a patient can sell to the dispensaries? Do we have any?
One time, not one time
to every dispensary, one time period?
Well, that's vague. So you know how we interpret that.
Right, of course. So, of course, we're going to err on the side of caution and say just one time total.
Not you.
But I want to be realistic for a moment. Okay,
bring us down to earth, Raymond.
Let's look at the number... Yeah, because we're all a little high right now. Let's look at the number of medical marijuana patients in the state.
6,300.
Okay, of them, let's be generous and say half of them grow.
That's generous.
Very generous. Okay, so you have 3,000. How many cultivation facilities do they open? If each patient is allowed to have 12 plants, you take 3,000, multiply it by 12, and then you get to sell once to either cultivation or dispensary.
Or production.
Right.
That's... Where are they going to get the medication to provide for the patients?
Right. That's what I was just going to say. What about them growing for themselves? Those 12 plants are supposed to be supporting themselves.
Well, I got to tell you the truth. I mean, Kurt and I don't grow 24 plants.
Yeah, and me and you would also not have near enough excess to sell to a dispensary. That is my point. The person who has got so much that they're going to be able to sell to a dispensary is growing way over their limit.
Over their limit. And
so you feel like
that's what I'm more afraid of, is Metro coming in and closing them down because they're growing too much, because they want to sell to a dispensary.
You know what? Because then, Kurt, well, it's their fault. They want to willingly break the law that so many people have fought and advocated for, so people have legitimate access to their medication.
Well, you see, that was the give and take. You see, there was this thing, you can have 12 plants, but in exchange, they wanted to have a felony for any one plant over.
Yeah.
And that seemed fair at the time. So once again, the bill was passed that could get passed at the time. And we, even with the Democratic majority, we barely got it by with the skin of our teeth. And
and
with these patients who were trying to sell a lot of product, I guess what you could do is you could probably get a contract with one of these up-and-coming dispensaries and say, look, you know, I can't provide you 20 pounds today, but I can provide you maybe 2 pounds at a time over a 6-month period, you know, or something like that.
Exactly.
For a total volume of 20 pounds, which
but
might
one sale.
Be interpreted as one sale potentially, yeah.
But what dispensary out there is going to want to pay for 20 pounds?
They're not going to.
Before
it'll be on
they
consignment.
Get the product.
It'll have to be on consignment, just like in California.
Yeah, you don't know what kind of product's coming out of that person. They might have one good crop that they're showing you today, but the next crop could be garbage.
I don't know, Kurt. Everything that you're growing lately seems pretty good.
And yeah. Of course, everything's
and I grow very
have
small
to be lab
scale,
tested.
And I give each plant
true.
A lot of love.
And don't forget though, testing is going to be needed on each and every single plant.
Batch, yeah.
Batches. And I've talked to the testing facilities. They got 24-hour turnaround time for
yeah.
So we're
no
good
doubt.
On that.
Well, that's pretty sweet. If it's only a day, I mean. That's no time
awesome,
at all.
But and I'm just still curious about those that really don't need the medication, that are just hoarding it to make a profit off of people.
You're going
to
get that.
Much like Big Pharma.
Look, you're going to get that. And we have issues like that in every industry. I mean, what are you going to do? We can't stop everyone. All we can do is make it easier for people who want to do it right to do it right. And we can only protect those people. We can't protect everyone. So,
well, I mean, in the end game for this, it's just, it's all uncertain. It's an uncertain outcome. And this much is true. The state and Clark County and city have all been pushing against each other, but the state eventually will trump them. And then Clark County would say, okay, well, we'll just deny everything the state sends us until they send us something that we want.
And this is the problem.
Which is petty and nasty.
Yeah, this is the problem. Just government run amok. You know, what government really has say-so over our lives? The federal government claims authority over state government. State government claims authority over county government. And county government claims representation over city government. Where does it stop? Where do our votes actually count?
You know? Well, I think the minute we vote them out.
I just have enough pride and value in myself that if I'm dictated what social norms are or how I'm supposed to govern myself, that I'm just going to operate within those confines. I mean, it's really not that difficult.
Well, speaking of personal freedom, on Saturday, the Hustler Cub is going to throw something with the Libertarian Party, and it's going to be very cannabis-centric. Exactly. We'll be putting it out through our website on the times and location and the date. If you were at the last Hustler Cub get-together, you will know there are dabs and tatas all around.
I good times. Do not recall being at that location.
I do not recall motorboating that girl.
Did you see that?
It's on.
No, I just know you, Raymond. Oh,
and I didn't inhale.
Yeah, Dean Martin Drive.
Yeah.
It's probably in the evening time on Saturday.
Yeah, it'll be Saturday evening. There'll be free food and beverage available. And
for 3 hours.
For 3 hours. So check our website and our Facebook for information. It'll be coming out here in the next couple of days.
Good
you
time.
Don't want to miss this one.
No doubt.
All right. Up in Reno, Reno is having the same kind of problems that we're having. They're basically, they don't know the businesses that are coming out because the businesses didn't sign a release form at the state. And so Reno citizens are concerned about who's operating those businesses, and they need to know their medical facilities. So the public needs to know these names and everything else. But this is how it was originally set up. So, I mean, in Reno saying that they need to know all of these people that are operating these businesses, they should have gone to the city council meetings and vetted the people like we did, huh?
Yeah, that's right.
Well, and no doubt people get nervous.
No, I think it's a little more, Jen. The problem cropped up when part of the old statutes related to the initial medical marijuana approval was scrutinized. It stated that the names of people who apply to get their medical marijuana card and those of their doctors are confidential.
Mm-hmm.
It also says that, quote, any application, record, or other written documentation, end quote, received in relation to the statute shall not be disclosed either. I don't know about you, but I don't want John Q. Citizen scrutinizing my medical records.
It's none of his business.
Well, this is a problem that was way back. Department of Health and Human Services, when it was still called that, before it was called Behavioral Services, they released a lot of information that they shouldn't have. And then now the HIPAA laws are tightened up, and they won't even let you release the demographics, like the age, the median age of the people that are getting their cards, which that age is over 40. I think it was over 68% of the people that get a medical marijuana card in Nevada are over 40 years old. I think that has been tightened up. I think that what they're talking about are the businesses, the people that are running the businesses.
And that's where you're right. Some have interpreted, quote, any applications, end quote, to mean businesses and their officers. The Division of Public Health was asked to reiterate the marijuana statute, so it is part of the state administrative code.
Well, you know, I think that's just lazy on the account of the reporters on this, because you can go to the Secretary of State website and look up who owns these businesses. You can go on the agendas of these public meetings and find out who the company is. Do your due diligence. You know, if they got a problem with secrecy in the state, it's like, eh, maybe if you go to the public meetings and look at the agendas, you can even review those meetings online in your home.
Exactly. Have they been good about that, making everything public and available? Like, we had a couple of issues with that down here. Like, oh, you know, some of the meetings aren't available, people aren't making them, and they're kind of putting them up last minute or things like that. As long as they're doing what they're supposed to do, then there aren't many excuses.
I know the agenda for the county and the city are always online prior to the meeting.
Correct. And so is North Las Vegas.
I've never been to any North Las Vegas. I know I can access any archived meeting.
Yep.
I myself rewatched the marijuana hearings for the city of Las Vegas because I was working at the time, and I was curious to hear about what some of the hubbub was about. Mm-hmm. You know, I wanted to see for myself, not witness someone else's reporting.
Yeah. One of the days of the county hearings, the approve-a-thon, but when they decided their Elite 18, I was sick and I was watching from home on my computer.
I remember that. You were sick and you were still engaged. We were still communicating. So there are numerous ways to get out there. So these people coming, Johnny come latelys, Johnny come early, okay? Come on now.
Yeah, the way that we figure out all, you know, everything that's in all these businesses is go to these public meetings and take an interest in our local politics, because, you know, if you don't take an interest in your local politics, they will plow you under.
Okay. My final 2 cents on this.
Oh, good. Okay, let's hear it.
If I could jump my happy self on the bus and deal with all the crap that I deal with on the bus, and you know there's a lot of that, John.
Yes, I've ridden with you on the bus before.
No excuses.
If I can jump on a bus, if I can roll out in the rain, then people that don't have the barriers that some people do should not have a problem getting and becoming involved. That's all I have to say.
Well, if you want to become involved, tomorrow is a banner day for becoming involved. The Clark County meetings start at 9:30 in the morning, and these are the preliminary approval for 8 dispensaries. The city of Las Vegas has meetings tomorrow about MMEs. It starts at 9:30, but our agenda numbers are 72 through 80 in the city, and so that's probably about noon and after.
I was going to say that'll probably make the afternoon session.
Yeah,
exactly. It'll probably be after lunch.
And then if you want to go all day, Go all day. North Las Vegas has 6:30 at night, their approve-a-thon. So we're going to have people at city meetings and North Las Vegas meetings to meet everybody and to talk about to all these potential dispensary owners, for sure.
Okay.
All right. Oh, now we've got news from northern Nevada. Well, not northern Nevada, kind of central
North
Nevada.
Clark County.
Mesquite.
Well, there was a Mesquite City Council meeting recently, and it went a little bit shorter than expected. What was scheduled for the evening ranged from agreements to business licenses, but the most controversial item on Tuesday's agenda was obviously the approval of a conditional use permit for Deep Roots Medical Production to set up and operate a medical marijuana establishment and related practices on Willis Carrier Canyon Road, Suite Number 400 in the Mesquite Technology and Commerce Center. This site is approximately 5 acres and has 2 pre-existing vacant warehouses that are approximately 40,000 square feet.
Each?
This site, yes. Or no, total. I'm sorry.
Okay.
This site will house 3 medical marijuana establishments. It'll house a cultivation facility, a production facility for edible and topical products, and a retail dispensary.
Finally, somebody got it right, huh? All three under one roof. Isn't that what the state said?
Well, they were
all against it at first, and then all of a sudden they flipped at the very end, right before I went to Alaska during the summer. I remember that happened, and one of our colleagues was very proud of that fact that they were able to flip them.
So it got approved.
Oh, yeah.
And aren't they the only one that got approved in Mesquite also?
Yeah, there were plenty of people in attendance Tuesday, which led many to assume there would be continual opposition for the medical marijuana issues. Even though council had passed the approval for it back in August, shockingly, there was none other than from council member Craig Hafen, who commented during the first of 4 items prior to voting, stating that he did not believe this is what Mesquite needed. In all 4 motions, Hafen was the lone nay vote, while each of the other 3 council members in attendance voted to approve the licenses. In a final public comment period, one of the owners of Deep Roots Production LLC spoke and said that the company is committed to proving that they will be beneficial to the community at large.
And that's awesome. I'm really glad that Hafen was just the lone shooter.
Well, you can't flip everyone. It happens. Don't worry so much.
Exactly.
Voters up in Mesquite, you remember that.
Exactly.
Well, I think it's about time for a break.
All right, it is about time for a break, and when we get back, we'll talk about the 420 moment, and we'll talk about the veterans issues in the news.
Fire up.
You're listening to the Nevada Cannabis News Hour, produced by WeCan, the Wellness Education Cannabis Advocates of Nevada. WeCan is a 501c3 nonprofit. If you're interested in sponsoring us, donating, or advertising on this radio show, please contact our advertising department at 702-218-5226 or Kurt, K-U-R-T, at wecan702.org.
GreenSpot Hydroponics is a Las Vegas-based distributor of specialty indoor and outdoor gardening supplies, locally owned and operated with over 3,000 square feet of inventory. Expert and friendly staff to help you with all your growing and hydroponic needs. Our pricing and service will not be beat. We help you grow. 3355 Westlake Mead Boulevard, just behind the Texas Station. Mention WeCan and receive 10% off. Call us at 702-463-6000. That's 702-463-6000.
Finally, Nevada medical marijuana dispensaries are opening, but you must have your medical marijuana card to get inside. Call the friendly team at Karma Holistic Health Foundation toll-free 855-420-1110 or visit getmedicalmarijuananow.com. Karma Holistic Health Foundation will give you legal access to medical marijuana. All veterans receive a discount. 855-420-1110 or visit getmedicalmarijuananow.com.
Welcome back. That sound indicates it's time for our 420 moment, where we honor somebody in the movement. And today we're going to honor Dee Powers of Las Vegas and founder of Karma Holistic.
Right on, Dee.
You just heard her commercial. She's here in Las Vegas. She runs Karma Holistic Health Foundation, which is a medical referral service. So if you need help getting your card, she would be one to talk to. And she's also doing a lot to help PTSD and veterans. You got a little on that, Jen?
Yeah, she has set up Karma Holistic Health Foundation, and that's a foundation in addition to her business that helps veterans and elderly people get their medical marijuana card for less expensive. She also feels really passionate about positive effect on medical marijuana with those that have PTSD. She offers 10% discount to veterans, hoping that they'll at least try an alternative medicine, instead of pills and stuff that they push at you. Happiness, love, and positiveness, that's what she says are all effects and side effects of cannabis. And she started her foundation in 2013 when her mother came to live with her and her mom was taking a lot of prescription pills. She helped her mom get off the prescription pills and helped her get onto a medication that would help her. So we honor you for this 420 moment, Dee.
Regular listener, too.
Yes.
Thanks for listening, Dee.
No doubt.
Thanks for listening. Yeah. All right. Next, we're going to talk about some PTSD issues with our special guest, Michael Karwitz. Hi, Michael.
Hi there.
How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on.
So you have a website, a foundation about medical marijuana and PTSD and patients?
Sort of. Yes, I'm the executive director of Veterans for Medical Cannabis Access. And Veterans for Medical Marijuana Access, the same thing. It started in 2007 by Marty Chilcutt out in Kalamazoo, Michigan, and we work on access issues, namely medical marijuana, but any medicinal access issues that veterans have.
Well, that's great. And so were you with this from the beginning, or did you just kind of join up with it because of a belief or a special
passion?
Reason or passion?
How did you get involved, basically?
Yeah, how did you get involved?
Well, I actually started out independently of Marty, and we kind of met at a crossroads, and a very important crossroads, I think a very good meeting. I'm a disabled U.S. Air Force vet myself, and
thank you for your service,
yes, sir.
Thank you. If it weren't for becoming disabled, I probably would have gone on to have my entire career without ever being an activist. You know how that can kind of go, but. A lot of free time when you're disabled. And I took my oath very seriously that I took and all the vets took. You know, when you join the service, you take an oath to uphold and defend the Constitution. And that kind of sticks with you and drives you a little bit. And I was working on issues inside the VA. And Marty was working on issues outside the VA. And we met up, and actually the combined effort is what produced the medical marijuana policy that now covers the VA system.
That's great. That came out in 2010. I especially remember that because as soon as that came out, I was just like, all right, that's almost like the government saying that it's got medical use because they're allowing their veterans to mm-hmm. be on this medical cannabis in states that it's approved.
Yeah, in fact, we had to basically prove our case to the VA before they would put that policy into effect. Essentially, what happened was we kind of cornered the VA into speaking authoritatively about the ethics involved. And the ethics are very clear. They always have been. It's never ethical to take away someone's medicine as a punishment, no matter what rules you violate. And that, together with the fact that we had these double-blind, placebo-based studies that the California state had done under the CMCR, the California's Medical Cannabis Research grants, and those studies were really excellent, and they were well done, and they showed a lot of promise for cannabis as a neuropathic pain medicine. You know, a lot of things we already knew. It was safe to use for a nausea and an appetite stimulant for AIDS and HIV. You know, these things were things we already knew, but once we were able to prove them to the VA, I think that gave them kind of the political cover to say what needed to be said, which is so subtle, really. All it says is that the veteran is allowed to use medical marijuana under the state program and not be punished at the VA hospital.
Well, you know, and that's a way to get around some of the governmental agencies, is basically that you get them to agree that what is already going on is better than in punishing people, you know, and helping veterans is really super important.
Well, we have data now. You know, the Journal for the American Medical Association came out with a great article, and some of that was instituted because of interest from the VA. That they did this study, and they found up to a 25% reduction in overdose deaths from opiates in areas around where medical marijuana was well established. So, you know, veterans are higher than an average in the opiate overdose death category. So this is something of great interest to the VA. And, you know, the VA still can't protect you if you possess marijuana. It's illegal under federal law. You're subject to arrest on federal property. And the most interesting thing, it turns out, for us has been the prohibition against doctors recommending it at the VA. And we never realized, I've been advocating, you know, for veterans stuff for a very long time, going back into the 1980s when I first got out of the service. The issues back then were Agent Orange exposure, to date me back then.
Oh, my.
And you know, now you know, we've got this situation where all of a sudden we realize that doctors at the VA don't have freedom of speech. I guess it never came up before, but it came up now because marijuana is illegal under federal law and being used at the state level. So the doctor at the VA can't talk about it. He's not free to discuss that with you proactively. If you come in with your medical marijuana documentation, then they're supposed to be an expert and be able to weigh the pros and cons to consider the, you know, the clinical safety, you know, value of this as a medicine in your treatment plan.
Well, how do you feel? Are the doctors well versed in this? So if you come in and you're asking a question as a veteran, do you feel that the doctors are as well versed as they should be in this, and that they need a little bit more education, or some are better than others? Just like, you know, everything.
I say none of the above. Actually, it's really worse than you might think, because really, not only is there no incentive for doctors inside the VA to go out and take continuing medical education credits on cannabinoids, but they don't get any credit for that. I mean, think about the ethical dilemma of you as a doctor sitting there at the VA, and let's say you've got someone across from you who's suffering through chemotherapy and has tried all the, you know, anti-nausea medicines and even Marinol, and nothing's really helping. And you know that if this were outside the VA, you would be able to recommend cannabis, but you can't. And I think that ethical dilemma would pretty well prevent them from even trying to pick up the subject. I mean, why would they want to learn? But at the same time, when a veteran comes in who's using medical marijuana under a state program, presents their information, according to policy, the doctor's supposed to be an expert at that point. They're supposed to immediately become educated so that they can weigh the pros and cons of this treatment and put it in, you know, integrate it into their care and make sure that, you know, they're getting the best treatment plan.
Well, I mean, for years I've been advocating to my doctor, I mean, years and years and years, and I would just I would have to be my own best advocate and bring in stuff to the doctor to educate the doctor on it until they got kind of sick of just hearing it from me, and I told them to start looking, you know, gave them websites and everything else. Is this also, you know, kind of what you do is advocate to the doctors for the soldiers?
Well,
or the veterans?
Well, we're working with the VA at the top, you know, working with the Undersecretary of Health and the various heads. You got the pain management system and the ethics committee at the VA. The National Center for Ethics and Healthcare has been extremely helpful, and it's been a give and take. We've given them a lot of information to help them understand, you know, our perspective and what we're seeing out there. And, you know, that is a way, a process, you know, that we're trying to get the VA to embrace this information. And hopefully, you know, on its own, it's a curious beast. It's taking care of so many, you know, veterans' health situations across the country. I'm sure there's a certain amount of institutional curiosity that's been piqued already by medical marijuana that will continue to demand research and demand, you know, more information. But I don't recommend, you know, it's kind of the one place where I defer a little bit from the ethics committee, because I don't really recommend a veteran to go in and ask questions or try to educate the VA about medical marijuana. If it doesn't come up as an issue,
it's a don't ask, don't tell.
You're clear of it.
Is it a don't ask, don't tell issue?
That's exactly kind of how I've been, you know, you know, putting it out there as a new don't ask, don't tell. If they don't ask you about it, don't tell them anything about it. Oh, and it's, you know, in the reverse, it's also...
Well, I was going to say there are now CEs for doctors about the cannabinoid system and all, and in the endocannabinoid system and all of the cannabinoids and how they plug into that. And so educating the doctors, the veterans doctors, you know, maybe that's what you can advocate for at the top instead of asking the soldier to do anything for sure.
I just don't recommend the veteran to walk in off the street and talk to primary care go into the window there for urgent care at the reception and start asking them about medical marijuana.
No, I'm not asking that. But when you're in a private room with your doctor you're telling your doctor the medications you use, you should tell them the medications that you use that help you.
Yeah,
I mean, shouldn't you?
They're in the doctor's office when you're speaking with your care provider. You need to tell them what they need to know. And if cannabis is being used in a setting where they're giving you some other medication that it may interact or you have any concern, if you want to research that, it's probably better to ask your cannabis providers and go that route and find out the information outside the VA and teach your doctor. but in the case that there is a need-to-know issue, yes, you should tell your provider what they need to know to be able to effectively treat you. But
well,
if
I mean,
you
part of your treatment plan.
But let me finish.
Sure.
If you want to educate the VA, though, and we've had great results from individual veterans working on this, but you just have to be careful with your tact. You write a letter to the director or the chief of staff, and you talk to them and try to educate them, and you give them information. And you know, from there, it'll flow down to your care provider. But if you try, you know, I'm just trying to prevent veterans from being kind of labeled a troublemaker.
Sure. I mean, I don't want anybody labeled a troublemaker, but when you're in with your doctor making a treatment plan for your treatment, and you should be advocating for yourself, and if part of your treatment not taking opiates or weaning yourself off opiates has to a large extent been cannabis, then I think that certainly should be told to your practitioner so that they know what is getting you off the opioids or the addictive medications or that you have an issue with addiction as a soldier or, you know, a veteran, that you want to get off these addictive medications and this is what you're using and it's working, so that they can add it into their antidotal, you know, medicine or for sure.
Well,
I absolutely agree. It's just a careful, you know, thing that you have to do when you're a patient. You got to kind of feel that out, you know.
Oh, for sure.
You don't want to get in a confrontation with your doctor about it, that's all.
Well, I guess the fix is in the works with the Veteran Equal Access Act. It was introduced on November 20th, and it would allow VA doctors to recommend medical marijuana to veterans. What can you tell us about the Veterans Equal Access Act? Where does it stand right now? And what can we, as American citizens and as advocates, do to help our veterans who have fought so bravely for the freedoms that we have each and every day?
Well, this it's a Milcon VA amendment. It's Congressman Blumenauer. Congressman Rohrabacher signed on as a co-signer, so it's a bipartisan thing. It's got quite a bit of support already. What you can do, anyone can go to their congressional representative and ask them to vote positively on this action, to support this action in any way they can. What the amendment would do would be to allow the doctors at the VA to recommend cannabis. It would remove that restriction. It would remove their free speech prohibition so that they could actually recommend cannabis. And that would actually remove, it wouldn't completely fix all the problems, and I'll get into that, but it would actually remove that restriction that really is keeping us from effectively educating all the doctors in the VA. Then, you know, there would no longer be that ethical dilemma. They'd be able to be taught about cannabis and cannabinoids in a more holistic way without worrying about, you know, them not being able to do anything with the information.
Am I correct in that no hearings on this act have been held yet? And do you know what the holdup might be?
Well, it's coming up. This is a, you know, new Congress, and I'm not even sure they may get a new number even as we come into the new year.
Yeah, with the new Congress, I believe they're going to have to reintroduce the bill.
Right, so it gets a new number. But the last time we did actually have this amendment put in last year. In much the same form, and we got a record vote. It was a little overshadowed because right after that we got a successful vote for the very first time on trying to restrict the DEA's funding, if you'll remember. But we actually got a very good vote on this, and there's every reason to believe if we all, you know, just put a little bit of focus on it that we should be able to get this passed. And I think the important thing is that I've talked to, you know, quite a few people on the inside of this, you know, either in Congress or at the VA, and it does seem like it will be well received. That is, they'll understand what we're saying. They'll understand that we don't agree, that this law should prohibit doctors from being able to freely discuss these issues with their patient, even a Veterans Affairs doctor. And once that is passed into law, the VA will understand that. Now, the problem is, you guys. Right out there in North Las Vegas, the VA Southern Nevada Healthcare System.
Yep.
Also in a couple of clinics out in Las Vegas and elsewhere, all the way into Los Angeles and San Diego, California, we're under a kind of an ad hoc policy that we just discovered recently that
really?
A mid-level VA official had put through saying that all veterans that were using medical marijuana would immediately have their pain medication tapered off and taken away from them. And much to our amazement, if you will, the VA has actually stepped in from the top and communicated with this mid-level administrator, and they've agreed to change that policy to bring it in line with national policy.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, so this is really, really good. But I want to make it clear to anybody out there, Henderson, Nevada, Las Vegas, Nevada, anywhere out there, if they're having trouble where their doctor's telling them, well, I got to do this, it's the rule I've been given, make sure they get a hold of us so that we can kind of track this problem and make sure that it's been corrected. You know, the policy needs to be changed, and all the veterans that have been affected by it need to be, you know, straightened out in their care. You don't get the benefit of cannabis as an adjunct if you don't let them use it as an adjunct. You know?
That's for sure. And so tell us all now how we can get a hold of you, and we'll also put it up on our Facebook site that if anything is going on in Henderson, North Las Vegas, Pahrump, you know, Las Vegas, that they should get a hold of you. We'll put it up on our Facebook site also after this. But how can our listeners get a hold of you if they have a complaint?
Well, there's an email form on the website, veteransformedicalmarijuana.org. The thing that we're most currently updating, actually, is our Facebook page. Go to facebook.com/USA.VMCA, Veterans for Medical Cannabis Access, VMCA. And if you send an email through the Facebook page, I'll get that. It'll get back to me. And I really do appreciate, the help that we get from everybody. It's really, really powerful for, you know, for the vets. We do appreciate it. And, you know, the vets are very quick to tell me, you know, we're not doing this for ourselves. We want anything that we're fighting for is, you know, because we recognize all patients benefit from this.
Yes, you know, you were talking about becoming disabled through your service. And as a disabled individual, I know what barriers that I face each and every day. Please do not hesitate to let me know what I can do to help you, because even if I can't serve my country in the armed services, at least I can do everything I can to help those I have.
Well, like I said, right now, this Blumenauer Amendment is really a good thing for everybody to focus on. It's a national act that would affect the entire VA system, and it would pave the way for the next step. We allow the doctors, the VA, to recommend it, then we educate them about how it's used and all this cannabinoid science that we're so excited about, and then finally we'll be able to engage the VA in some meaningful research and some meaningful treatment plans.
Absolutely. Did the researcher Sue Sicily from Arizona that she got canned from University of Arizona with PTSD research, she recently just resurfaced in Colorado, didn't she?
Yes, and we're very deeply involved in that. We're very supportive of Dr. Sicily and MAPS. It's a multidisciplinary association for psychedelic studies. And evidently, Rick Doblin, the leader of MAPS, has been working for like 20 years to get access to the marijuana in Mississippi grown, you know, by the U.S. government. That, you know, the same marijuana that they give to a handful of patients in those big tins every mm-hmm. month. He tried for 20 years to get access to it, and it wasn't until, you know, we really stepped in and made it a veterans issue that and threatened to go to Congress. We were actually at Congress working on a congressional bill to overdo that when they actually relented and gave him access to the marijuana. And the vets, we stood in and said, no, we're not going to go away. We're going to make sure that the extra barriers and extra hoops that you have to jump through to get medical marijuana for research go away. So we're sticking with that as well. And that right now is still working its way through Congress. We're looking for, you know, more congressional support to remove the barriers to access to cannabis, which can be done even in Schedule 1. Obviously, it should be taken out of Schedule 1 at the federal level, but even in Schedule 1, you can get rid of those extra hoops that have been created by law.
That's great. That's great. And do you know that the federal government is growing so much cannabis right now that not only are they supplying those very few patients, I think there's like, what, two people left alive? There's five people left alive, and the excess of what they're growing is like, where is all that excess going? What are they doing with it?
They're the official cultivars to the United States of cannabis. So anybody that wants to study anything legitimately in a university setting, you know, and actually publish those findings, they have to get it, you know, according to the DEA, they can only get it through that one supply. So, you know, they do a lot of studies to test, you know, drug sniffing dogs or new types of drug tests. You know, it's not human studies on cannabis that they usually do, and for good reason. They make it nearly impossible to do so. And we, you know, while we know cannabis works well for post-traumatic stress because we can see it with our own eyes working well, you know, in the patients, but we also have a lot of science. It's not something that we don't know anything about. Actually, we know quite a bit about the mechanism of how cannabis helps these patients. So, you know, what we really need is fine research that tells us, you know, how these different strains are doing different things, and you know, kind of come up with some sort of you know, silver bullet cannabis pill that we can give to universal patients if that's possible. You know, those are great things to aspire to, but
yeah,
don't let them get in the way of patient access. You know,
well, Michael, is there? Can we get back with you and follow up and see how things are going down the line?
Absolutely, anytime.
Fantastic. All right. We thank you for calling in. We thank you for this discussion. We're going to take our last break, guys. And when we come back, we have a little more local news and more and news about the breath test for marijuana.
Thank you, Michael.
Do you need help getting your Nevada medical marijuana card? Dr. Reefer is now accepting new patients. There are no medical records required. We have a doctor on staff to give you a thorough physical examination. There is a 99% approval rate for patients. They also have a money-back guarantee. If you don't qualify, you don't pay. Free consultation is available. Call 702-428-0000. 702-428-0000 to get your Nevada medical marijuana card today. The Von Dank Group offers turnkey solutions for all your cannabis needs, bringing transparency and responsibility to a young budding industry. Helping patients by producing the cleanest, safest, and most potent medicines and infusibles possible. The Von Dank Group is a design, management, and consulting corporation with over 30 years of industry experience and knowledge of the dispensary, edibles, infusible kitchen, and large-scale cultivation of cannabis manufacturing facilities. Let the Von Dank Group help you grow your cannabis business from seed to green. www.vondank.com.
You're listening to the Nevada Cannabis News Hour, produced by WeCan, the Wellness Education Cannabis Advocates of Nevada. WeCan is a 501c3 nonprofit. If you're interested in sponsoring us, donating, or advertising on this radio show, please contact our advertising department at 702-218-5226 or Kurt, K-U-R-T, at WeCan702.org.
Welcome back to Nevada Cannabis News Hour. I'm Raymond, along to my left with Jen Solis, Kurt Juhat, Beach, and to my right is Perry. Perry's got some news for us.
Well, this kind of goes back to what we were just talking about with our previous guest. He was talking about how he has been getting reports through his organization that veterans have been denied their opioid pain medications by their doctors at the VA. Well, we've been running into that on a local level here. I've been getting reports privately from patients that said that their Walgreens pharmacists are refusing to fill their opioid pain medications due to the fact that they are medical marijuana patients. If there are any local patients out there who are experiencing this kind of blatant discrimination from any pharmacy, please contact WeCan immediately so we can look into this. I've been talking to a lot of different pharmacists from, you know, CVS pharmacies and Smith's and all these other places, and they don't know what I'm talking about. They seem to be, we have marijuana patients come in here all the time, and we give them their medicine. And then what immediately clicked in my head as soon as I got in my car after I left that one pharmacy, exactly. As soon as I left, they said, well, how do you know? So my question now becomes, are these patients willingly forking over this information? Because I don't really have a personal relationship with my pharmacist like I do with my doctor. So I wonder whether they're forking over the info or whether they're getting it from someone else, because if the information's being distributed to these pharmacies, that's a problem, because they're kind of playing doctor. They're telling people what they should and shouldn't be taking, and that's a big problem for me. So.
Well, and the other thing is if they're finding out from some other resource that these people are medical marijuana patients, that's a HIPAA law violation.
Yeah, that's illegal. Yeah.
It's illegal. And if they're denying people medication, their opioid medication that has been prescribed to them simply because they're a medical marijuana patient, again, that is illegal.
Well, they just hate the dope and they hate the dopers.
Okay, you know? So a licensed
So how many people have you heard? Just a couple.
But so, it's just, I wonder whether people are kind of afraid to come out of the closet on the issue because they think, maybe something is amiss or whatever. Maybe they just don't want to talk about it. So I'm hoping maybe when we're getting it out there, the floodgates will open slightly and people will be more willing to express their concerns about this issue. But this is, I want to start talking about it before it becomes a bigger
news
issue. Yeah.
Well, the other thing is it seems like so many things that we are reporting on this show are tomorrow's RJ or in tomorrow's Channel 8 and tomorrow's Fox 5 news about medical marijuana. And so, you know, if anybody is getting any of the flack from their pharmacist about their opioid medications in conjunction with their medical marijuana, get a hold of us. We'd like to talk to you. I can even put you in touch with, another reporter and get you a news story or get you on here and talk about it.
Yeah, if there's a story to find, we're going to dig it up for sure.
Speaking of digging up stories,
one of our local political pundits who's so nicely digging up stories on people is getting canned off his show.
Yeah, John Ralston, man.
Yeah, John Ralston's getting kicked off the air on, I think, December 12th is his last show. Jim Rogers from News 3 died recently. And
Jim was a great mm-hmm. advocate for not only education, but he was also a medical marijuana proponent.
Yes.
He wanted all the stupid shows off of his channel. He said that he dumped Judge Judy and a bunch of these other crappy shows.
He dumped Wheel of Fortune. He didn't dump Jeopardy.
Not Jeopardy.
He dumped Wheel of Fortune, Judge Judy, and a couple others. I remember having a meeting with him and one of our colleagues about his programming. We were trying to get a cannabis weekly television show on Channel 3, and they just didn't have room for it. He just wanted to expand the news. He always felt like people just needed to be more enlightened and not dumbed down with programming. And kind of a shame that they're just expanding what, like, they have hours and hours of local news. We need, you know, I don't say we need Ralston, but he's the only person out there doing what he does on TV right now.
He was super hard hitting. And, you know, with Jim Rogers gone and this new head of, you know, the
Sinclair Entertainment
Group, that they just said, oh, we don't need that type of show. Oh, yes, we do.
Yeah, they don't need it. I'm just hoping that one of these other news organizations around time, Fox 5 or Channel 8 or 13, will pick him up and hopefully give him some time.
You know, he's the one that asks the hard-hitting questions of the politicians, and he gives them crap, man. So you know what, John? If you want to come on our
come on our radio show.
If you want to come on our radio show and talk about, you know, your position, you're welcome on it. And so join us on Weekend Radio. We'd love to have you.
So, and in other local news, Weekend just hosted their inaugural Thanksgiving weekend potluck.
Oh, that went really well too.
Yeah, it was a smash. It was at a new venue, and
great venue.
Everyone seemed to love it, and
especially Danky.
That's right, and there was some really good food. I mean, the turkey, the ham, the Amster yams.
The Amster yams, those were freaking awesome.
Man, those edibles were some of my favorites of all time. That cake was just unbelievable.
And you know what? We gave patients a little to-go bag so that they didn't over-medicate at the event. You know, and everybody appreciated their to-go bag. So do you guys think that we should throw a holiday party?
Oh, definitely.
If it was up to me, I'd vote yes with Kurt, no doubt.
Yeah, I think we should do it on the Saturday between Christmas and New Year's.
You want to do it after Christmas?
Yeah, do an after Christmas potluck.
December 27th. So we're going to throw it up there. That we're going to do an after holiday party
on
December
20th.
Yeah. On December 27th, and it's going to be a potluck, same type of situation in the same venue. This time we're going to have a charge for it. We're going to charge $10 admission.
And
it's for patients and non-patients. And remember, this money is going to get us up to legislature this session in February to fight for patient rights like we have been doing every single session.
And also help other patients. This last at the Thanksgiving dinner, it was a free event. We did pass the hat and we did do a raffle. We earned enough money to cover the cost of the event and help another patient. And we chose a patient from the party that was there to sponsor onto the program. So
yeah, no doubt. The more generous you guys are, the more people we're able to help in the long run. So, you know, thank you so much for your continued support of Weekend, all of you.
Yeah, for sure. All right. We have, let's talk about our local announcements. This Friday, we have our weekend booth, 6 p.m. to midnight. And that's out at First Friday. And that's on Boulder Street in between the Artifice and the Arts Factory.
Right,
it's our same Danky location. Yeah, exactly.
Yep, same place we always are. It's going to be cold, so dress warm and bring some gloves.
And bring some gloves. All right. On December 9th, we have a radio host, Lanny Swernlow.
And he was just on.
Yeah, no, that was Michael Karwitz. And he hosts Nevada Compassion and Common Sense. It's a radio show in California. And so
you
we're
mean California.
Huh?
You mean California Compassion.
Yes.
No, Marijuana Compassion and Common Sense.
Oh, you said Nevada Compassion.
Oh, okay. Marijuana Compassion and Common Sense, and his name is Lanny Swernlow. He's going to talk about the California MMJ situation there. Let's see, Clark County Library, we have a
upcoming job fair in January.
Mm-hmm.
In January. If you'd like to host or to have a booth at our job fair, you can contact us through our website. And there is a cost for having a booth for your job. But this is no cost to people that are seeking jobs in the cannabis industry.
And we've had lots of interest from the dispensaries. We have two dispensaries that said they're hiring. And also Las Vegas Hempfest has contacted us. They're going to be hiring for their next event, full-time positions at our job fairs.
And they said 15 people. They need 15 people.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a blast next year, no doubt.
Absolutely.
Let's see. So I think about wraps it up this year, doesn't it? For
this
show.
Goodness.
Oh, wait. Don't forget
city council tomorrow.
Oh, that's right.
County commissioners.
What
tomorrow.
Time is the city council meetings
city
in the morning,
council
right?
City starts at 9:30.
Then the
county commission is at 9. North Las Vegas is at 6:30.
All day long, folks. All day long. If you want to stay involved, show up to your local city council meetings and be the change you want to see.
And if you can't show up in person, they are simulcast live on the website and also Channel 2. So if you'd like to sit at home and still be involved, you have plenty of ways that you can keep involved with the community.
That's right. No excuses.
So, all right, everybody, I want you guys to be safe out there, and we'll talk to you next week. Thank you.